excited to have you here today, and we're going to begin this morning as we worship the Savior. Let's stand together as we open up and sing.
Time of the year. You know, they say Christmas is the most wonderful time of the year, but Easter is the most high and holy time for believers, where we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ and use the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And we begin today strictly focusing on what Jesus Christ has done for us. And we're so thankful that you're here to be a part of this celebration of the Lord Jesus Christ, His life, His love for us, and the forgiveness that is found in Him. If you have not already filled out your information card, that's in your bulletin. We ask that everybody fill that out. And then when you leave at the end of the service, if you just drop in the offering drop box, you can do it at the back of the church by the exit. And we're going to have a great time this morning. We're glad that you're going to be a part of it. Let me lead us in a prayer this morning as we focus on my eyes and our hearts on the Lord. Oh, Father God, as we come before you, we are just humbly reminded of your great love, the mercy. Would reach out to us who cannot save ourselves, but you, in your mercy and your love, have done what we cannot do. You provide the sacrifice for our salvation. And so we come into your presence today, worshiping you, praising you, and may our lives be transformed by who you are, so that we live in a way that reflects the image of Jesus Christ. For a world that needs you so much. It's in the wonderful name of Christ we pray. Amen. May you see.
prepared and journeyed to Jerusalem, he sent two of his disciples ahead and told him, "Go into the village ahead of you. As soon as you enter it, you will see a colt tied there. You must mount it and get it set. Untie it and bring it." They brought the colt to Jesus, and he was told him, "He sat on it." Jesus spread his clothes on the road. Others spread leafy branches stuck in the field. Those who went ahead and those who followed shouted, "Hosanna! Blessed be the he who comes in the name of the Lord." Shouts of Hosanna faded quickly in the crowd of mockery and despair. The chief priests, the scribes, and the elders had become threatened by Jesus' authority. And Barabbas, who was claimed to be the Messiah, they placed him on trial for blasphemy and led to his sentence in the hands of the jeering mob of the Romans. Misunderstood, rejected, despised, Jesus humbled and accepted them. The long descended to the crucifixion and laid down his life and gave it for the sins of all mankind. Selflessly, Christ embraced the full punishment that was visited upon his road to be for me. This final and mortal breath brought complete forgiveness and redemption because of the cross of Calvary, death, and victory.
My God's word is as my spirit, my life when we have to walk again. Heal my guilty soul in holding earth to me. Now my wrath is broken, only thing of Calvary. My burden souls are liberty at Calvary. Oh, God,
shapes the foundations of hell, causes evil and darkness to hide. The name that heals and restores, the name that rules and reigns, the name that is full of the resurrection power and glory, the name that is the strength and the angel to all things.
Oh,
see the Spirit of God. That's the first of all. The Spirit of invention. All is the promise of the resurrection power. So, please rejoice. Jesus Christ. Everlasting. We will see the Lord of glory. The bridge. Yes.
Thank you.
who He is, King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and I hope you know just how great God is. Turn your Bible to the book of Hebrews chapter 4, and also take the sermon insert from your bulletin. There are many other verses that we'll be looking at. These are provided for your convenience and your further study, but our focus is in Hebrews chapter 4. I will begin reading this morning in verse 14. Hebrews 4, verse 14, where the scripture says, "Therefore, since we have a great high priest who has gone through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to the faith that we profess. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet without sin. Let us then approach the throne of grace with confidence, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need." We have been, for the past several weeks, in a series of messages entitled "Forgive." Forgive. And I hope you're learning that the Bible has so much to say about forgiveness. And one thing that we said, that forgiveness is a common issue. It is a common issue. By common, I mean we all need forgiveness. And we all need to forgive. We've all hurt others, and we've all been hurt. So it's common with all of us that we need to be forgiven, and we need to forgive others. But not only is forgiveness a common issue, but it's also a complex issue. It involves many things. And sometimes we confuse other issues with forgiveness. And we think that I have to do this before I can am able to forgive. And because many times the things that we think mean to be forgiveness, of what forgiveness is, are not really what forgiveness is. It's a separate issue. It hinders us from being able to forgive. So forgiveness is a common issue. It is also a complex issue, but it is also a critical issue. If we do not forgive, if I do not learn to practice forgiveness, and if I do not receive forgiveness, primarily from God, it will affect the entirety of my life. It will affect whether I am at peace. It will affect whether I have joy, contentment, and satisfaction. It will affect my relationship, not just with people who hurt me, but it can spill over into all of my relationships. So it's so critical that we understand forgiveness. It is a common issue. It is a complex issue. It is a critical issue, and it is a cross issue. One reason I planned this series on forgiveness leading up to Easter is because forgiveness is based in the crucifixion and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. I cannot be forgiven of my sins without the cross. And it's because of what Jesus did on the cross that I am able to forgive others. So it's very important that we understand the significance of what Jesus did on the cross, and we've been talking about that the past several weeks, and we'll talk more in the weeks ahead about the significance of Christ. But you know, sometimes as we think about forgiveness, and we think about hurts that occur and how we have been hurt, sometimes we think about hurts as physical hurts, and sometimes we think of them as emotional hurts. They're all physical hurts, and there's sometimes emotional hurts. Sometimes they overlap. But this morning we want to talk about particularly emotional hurts and the importance of dealing with them biblically. And the first thing I want you to notice in your outline is that emotional hurts can be more painful and last longer than physical hurts if they're not dealt with biblically. Emotional hurts can be more painful than physical hurts in so many ways. And the results of them can last longer than physical hurts. Sometimes a physical hurt will heal. But many times our emotional hurts last longer than physical hurts unless they are dealt with biblically. Now, on your outline, I put Romans 9, verse 2, where the Apostle Paul speaks of some of his emotional hurts. And in Romans 9, verse 2, he said, I have great sorrow and unceasing anguish in my heart. And he was writing in particular about some emotional hurts and pains that he had experienced as he did the ministry, as he witnessed and preached and shared the gospel of Jesus Christ. And that may surprise us to think that he had so many hurts in association with doing the will of God. Because a lot of times we think, well, if I just do the will of God, if I just become a Christian, then I won't have any more hurts. Your life will just be smooth. It'll be smooth sailing. God will protect me from all the physical hurts and emotional hurts. But that's just not true. Many times in life, even as Christians, many times when we're slap dab in the middle of God's will, doing what he wants us to do, we will be hurt deeply, emotionally. And we must deal with those hurts in a way that is biblical. Now, we've heard that saying many times, sticks and stones may break my bones, but words will never hurt me. But I think I know the intent of that little rhyme. I believe the intent of that rhyme is to say that we're not to be overly sensitive to things that people say, because people will say things that can hurt our feelings, but we're not to be overly sensitive to things that people say or what people think, and we're to have no confidence in who we are, not so much what everybody else says. But to say that words will never hurt is not true, because many times both spoken and unspoken words of people hurt very, very deeply. And so I put this a little highlight or asterisk bullet point there on your outline that says some of the most difficult hurts to deal with are betrayal, rejection, ongoing criticism, abandonment, lack of affection, lack of respect, non-affirmation, and are not being able to measure up, especially when those things are coming from people who should be doing the opposite. But someone that should be loving you, someone that should be affirming you and encouraging you, is critical of you or does not encourage you, that hurts many times very deeply. When someone that is close to us, like a parent or a spouse or a close friend, hurts us in those ways, it is deeply, deeply painful. A parent is to love their children. A parent is not to reject their children. A spouse is not to reject their spouse, the one they chose to be married with. And emotional pain causes deep hurt. Sometimes it's harder for us to deal with than physical pain. So the second thing we need to understand is that when we are emotionally hurt, our normal need is to have our emotional pain understood. A part of our normal being as people, when we are hurt emotionally, is to have that emotional pain understood. Now, there's a tendency, particularly with men, to suppress when they are hurt their emotional pain. You know, we're told we're not supposed to show emotion or to show pain. We'd be so tough, and sometimes we suppress our emotional pains, and it makes it hard in dealing with this need that we as men have and women to have our hurts understood. So just kind of place that in your mind right now, that all of us have a normal need, and I believe it's called that is our God-given need, to have our pains and our emotional pains understood. So just hang on with that thought. We're going to talk about that next. Which brings us to point number three. When hurt, God commands us to forgive our offender. But our need to have our pain understood to forgive our offender is a different issue. See, many times we confuse the issues, and we say forgiveness is a complex issue. A lot of times we bring other issues into what it means to forgive, and they get us all messed up. And one of the things that we, you know, have many times is that I need my offender, the one that hurt me, whether it was physically or emotionally, I need them to understand how they hurt me, and I need them to understand how they hurt me before I can forgive them. But that's not true. We don't, they're separate issues. God commanded us to forgive, and then being understood is a different issue. it's a different process that we work through, sometimes in rebuilding the relationship, but also in providing health and well-being emotionally for us. So forgiveness is something God commanded us to do. Being understood is a different issue and a process, which brings us on the inside of outline to number four. Your offender may never understand your pain and hurt. But that does not mean you have to live in the emotional pain forever. We have a need to be understood when we've been hurt. But the one who offended you may never understand your pain. They may not even acknowledge the pain and the hurt they caused you. But just because your offender does not acknowledge the pain and the hurt does not mean you have to stay in that forever, for the rest of your life. Think about this. In Luke chapter 23, verse 34, when Jesus was on the cross, remember he said several things when he was on the cross, and one thing he said was, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do." They don't know what they have done in crucifying. They don't understand. They may not even have the ability to understand what they did in crucifying Jesus Christ. You see, the forgiveness was not based on their understanding. It is a command. God commands us, and he said, "Father, forgive them." But they don't even know what they're doing. So our forgiving of others is not based on their understanding. Now, remember a couple of weeks ago we talked about that prayer of serenity, the serenity prayer, where it said, "Lord, grant me the serenity, the peace, the stability, the untroubledness of heart, to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things that I can change, and the wisdom to know the difference." The wisdom to know the difference in things I cannot change, and the wisdom to know the things that I can change. Remember, we talked about there's some things you cannot change. You cannot change the past. You cannot change what somebody did. You cannot change what somebody said. You can't change how somebody hurt you. You're not responsible for redoing the past. But what you can change and are responsible is what you do for today and what you do with tomorrow. How you respond to what people have done to you. You cannot make somebody else understand. So what do you do? How do you deal with the hurt? How do you deal with emotional pain of the past? That's the question. How do you deal with it? And that brings us to point number five. I must transfer my need to have my hurt understood from my offender to Christ. I must transfer my need, because we all have a basic need when we hurt, to be understood. Many times our offender cannot do that, or he won't do it, or he doesn't fully understand it. So I must transfer that basic need that we as people have to be understood and I hurt from my offender to transfer it to Christ. Now, we said that we have this normal need, and we many times suppress it, and that keeps us locked in the hurt and the pain of it. But when we transfer our need to be understood from our offender to Christ, that gives us the freedom and that gives us relief. Now, that passage we read in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 14, speaks to this. It says, "Therefore, since we have a great high priest who ascended to heaven, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to the faith we profess, for we do not have a high priest who is unable to empathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who's been tempted in every way, just as we, but without sin. Let us then approach the throne of grace with confidence to find mercy and grace in our time of need." So we can approach the throne of grace with confidence to find mercy and grace to help us in our time of need. We're in need when we've been hurt, and we need to have healing. And it says, because we have Jesus as our high priest, our intercessor, he is one who empathizes with us, he's one who sympathizes with us, and that helps us in dealing with our hurt. Not so much, it does help us in the forgiveness, but it's the dealing with it and being understood are different issues. I must transfer my need to be understood from my offender, who is unable many times or unwilling to do it, to God, to Jesus Christ. And Jesus is perfectly able and capable to empathize and sympathize with our hearts, whatever they are. There's a little difference in empathy and sympathy. Jesus does both. Sympathy is just when you feel sorry for somebody from your perspective. What they're going through. Empathy is when you actually become identified with their sorrow and pain. You feel it. You understand it fully. And you enter into it. Jesus sympathizes and he empathizes with us. How is that? Well, he understands and he identifies with our hurts and pains because he's God. He understands all things. But also by what he experienced while he was on earth. Because what Jesus went through on this earth, when he left the doors of heaven, came to earth, lived as a man, the Word became flesh, dwelt among us, because of what he experienced on earth, he is able to sympathize perfectly and empathize with us and identify with our sufferings and our hurts, even our emotional hurts. You remember a couple of weeks ago we said when Jesus died on the cross, he suffered in three ways. He suffered physically, because he drug nails into his head, they beat him, they crucified him. He suffered emotionally, he was abandoned and forsaken. He suffered spiritually, he took on the sins of all mankind. Sometimes we suffer in all those ways, Jesus suffered in all those ways. Let me just kind of remind you of a few of the ways Jesus suffered, what he experienced on this earth. He was homeless. Some of his family thought he was crazy. Instead of his God. Some of his best friends deserted him in his greatest time of need. One of his friends sold him to be killed just for other things. He was betrayed. He dealt with gossip and slander. Things about him were said that were totally untrue. He was unfairly shamed publicly on the cross. He received relentless criticism for his ministry. His message was primarily rejected by those who said he received it gladly. He endured complete separation and isolation from God. He suffered and he died alone on the cross, not because of himself, but because of his great love for you and me. And Jesus, because of who he is and because of what he suffered, identifies with us in our suffering. He completely understands and takes on our suffering with him to enable us to heal from it. Look at Acts chapter 9, verse 4 and 5 in your outline. Acts chapter 9, verse 4 and 5. Now, this is the story about the Apostle Paul before he became a Christian. Before Paul was Paul, his name was Saul. And he could not stand Jesus, the message of Jesus Christ, or Christians who said they were living for Jesus and spoke the gospel. And so the apostle Saul, before he became the apostle Paul, made it his life goal to persecute Christians, to bring as much pain and heartache and sorrow to Christians as he possibly could. Until one day, after Jesus had been crucified and resurrected, Saul met Jesus. And in Acts chapter 9, verse 4 and 5, this is what it says. Saul fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? Who are you, Lord?" Saul asked. "I am Jesus, whom you are." Jesus had been resurrected. Jesus was on the earth. And Saul wasn't persecuting Jesus. He was persecuting Christians. But Jesus said, "Saul, in your hurting of Christians, you are persecuting me." Because a believer and Jesus are perfectly identified together. And when we hurt, Jesus identifies with us. He empathizes with our suffering. He empathizes with our pain. So when someone hurts, Jesus feels it. when you suffer, Jesus understands. He identifies with it, and he moves into action as a result of it. When we are hurt, we transfer our need of understanding from our offender to Jesus Christ. And we find the sufficiency of his ability to understand and to identify with our hurt. And there is healing in the fact that he identifies with us. Not only do we transfer our need to be understood, but we also transfer those other needs that we have in life as people. Our need for love, our need for acceptance, our need for affirmation. We transfer those from many times from people that are not giving them, we transfer them to God. And when we transfer them to God or to Christ, we find that Christ loves us perfectly. He affirms us in him. He doesn't affirm us in sin, he affirms us in Christ. And he encourages us, he comforts us. So we transfer the things many times we look for in people, we transfer them to Christ. And when we transfer them to Christ, we find that he brings healing from those hurts. Now, on your outline is one other verse, in Jeremiah 46. So let me give you the kind of the background of Jeremiah 46, verse 11. Back in Genesis 37, verse 25, it talks about this caravan that was making their way with camels and things loaded up on the camels. And it talks about in that passage in Genesis that some of the supplies that this caravan was coming from, they were coming from a place called Gilead. And part of the supplies they were bringing for Gilead, from Gilead was some balm, B-A-L-M, a lotion or an ointment that had a strong medical ability to provide healing from hurts and injuries that one had received. And they were bringing this balm from Gilead and taking it to other places to trail as to trade and to sell to people in need of it. Well, when we come to Jeremiah 46, verse 11, God is speaking and he says to the people, go up to Gilead and get balm. Virgin daughter Egypt, but you try many medicines in vain, and there's no healing for you. He says, there is a balm in Gilead that will give you healing, but you're looking in all the wrong places for healing when this balm is there, and it can bring healing. And he's talking about this physical healing nature of this balm, but he's also making a spiritual application. See, many times we look all many different directions for the healing of our soul, the healing of our spirit. Sometimes we look to our offender to do something, and not until they do something do we feel like we can be healed, or sometimes we look to type psychology or something so we can be healed from our hurts, or sometimes we look to self-help books just to pull ourselves up. But the Bible says there is a balm in Gilead to your sensitive soul. There is one named Jesus who can provide what you need to provide healing for your soul. But you must look to him. Don't look to all the things that the world offers, but instead look to Jesus Christ. So, I must transfer my need for understanding, my need for healing from the offender or from other people to Jesus Christ is completely sufficient. He's our Father. We did it. And then, last, number six, the church is the body of Christ that is to be the physical presence of Christ in a world among the hurting. The church, the people of God, if you are saved, you're part of the church. And we express being a part of the church by being in a church, in a local church. Well, what good is it if you're just out yonder somewhere? God commands us to be a part of a local church. As a part of a church, the people of God, we're the body of Christ, and we are to be the presence of Christ in a hurting world. I think we'd all agree our world's hurting. In many ways, spiritually, it's hurting physically, it's hurting emotionally. Our world and so many people filled with pain and suffering and sorrow. And the church, the people of God, will be the hands and the feet, the mouth of God in our world. We are to provide the bridge from the hurt to Christ. And we are, in doing so, a comforter and an encourager. See, part of the work of Christians is to encourage the hurting. We're not to encourage them in sin. A lot of times we hear that going on, that, oh, yes, I'm okay, yo, this is okay. That doesn't encourage anybody to stay in sin. Stay in sin. We encourage people to come to Christ for their healing. And there's several scriptures that speak of this particular role for them to be a Christian. That we are to be the presence of Christ in our world that is hurting so much. Let me just give you a couple of references. 1 Corinthians 12, verse 26. Talking about the body of Christ. It says, if one part suffers, every part suffers with it. If one part is honored, every part rejoices with it. This is all about part of our identity with each other. We identify as the body of Christ. And when one part suffers, we suffer with the part. And that has pride and courage. See, there's a healing that occurs when sorrow is shared. Almost every funeral I do, I refer to Romans 12, 15. It says, rejoice with those who rejoice, weep with those who weep. There's a feeling, there's a comfort that comes when sorrows are sad. And when we seek the best that we can in the frailties of our humanness to identify with those who hurt. You're a believer. And if you're a believer, every one of us, we've been lost. And then you know what it needs to be found. Our world is people who are lost spiritually, who are hurting emotionally, some hurting physically, and need to be healed by Jesus Christ. And many times they're looking for you or me or someone who will come alongside them and give them an encouragement to look at Jesus Christ, where they can find the bottom of healing and heal themselves. Most important question, have you received the forgiveness of Jesus? Have you been cleansed of your sins because of his death, his burial, and his resurrection that we just prayed about? Have you been forgiven? God says, believe upon me, place your faith in what Jesus Christ did for you, that what he did on the cross is completely sufficient for your salvation. Believe upon what he did, look in, and you'll be saved. And as believers, we can forgive as we have been forgiven. Is everybody here this morning? Father, thank you so much. That in our weakness, in our frailty in this world that we live in, that you have provided through the cross, not only our forgiveness, but our forgiving of others, and to be obedient to you, and how we live your good. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. That decision concerning the relationship with Christ, I encourage you to make it as we sing the song of commitment. You stand with me as we sing.
There is a need in my love for you, and every soul is yours. It sounds like music in my ears, the sweetest music on earth. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me. Because he loved the Lord of love, he died to set me free. Because he had his precious love, the sweetest and perfect king. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Jesus, oh, how I love Jesus, because he first loved me, because he was my father, he fought for every day, and though I paid a price for that, you can't shine all the way. Oh,
Jesus. And I hope you love the choir this morning singing about the great love of God that He's done for us. We appreciate so much the work and their effort in helping us see God's great love for us. I tell you, Easter, like I said, is a wonderful time when we really are mindful what God is doing for us. Next Sunday morning, Easter Sunday morning, we'll be having our sunrise Easter service outside in the east parking lot at 6 a.m. So rise and shine. Hopefully it'll be shining Easter morning. We will provide chairs. I don't know what the weather will be like, but you come appropriately, bring blankets. Sometimes people bring blankets and wrap up in those. If it's raining, we will make other adjustments for you to be on the pavilion or in the house. I think we've been doing a sunlight service probably ever since I've been here 33 years in some form or fashion. I think I only remember one time it was pouring. One time it was like 20 degrees. It was pretty chilly. But we're having sunlight service, rain or shine, because we want to celebrate what Jesus Christ has done and arriving for us. And then, after the sunrise service, we have a full breakfast in the fellowship hall. We've had to kind of cut that out the last couple of years, but we're good to go for breakfast, a full party breakfast Sunday morning after the sunrise service. And then we have our normal, our regular schedule Easter morning. We have Sunday school at 8:30, Sunday school at 9:40, worship at 9:40, and worship at 11, like during the 11 o'clock service. The sunrise service and the two morning services are totally different. Different music, different message. You'll be in both. Great times of celebration, like I said last thing. Well, it's the same thing at 6 as it is at 9:40, and something at 6 that is different music, different message, talking about Jesus' crucifixion, His resurrection, His significance, all that sort of thing. You need to both and encourage somebody to come. People are more open to come at Christmas and at Easter than any other time of year. God can use you to bring somebody to hear the gospel. Drawing closer to you. Tommy, what greater thing is there than to help be that bridge of encouragement to somebody coming to know the Lord Jesus Christ and to try to help in their time and to be that person this week? But as you're here, we're going to sing our closing song before we go. For being with us today. We also hope to see you Wednesday night, 6:30. Thank you for being here. Choir guys, I need you to help here, please.